that will not let me go.
Oh, come on now, that wasn't fair. That wasn't made for you. That was for
the Oh, sorry.
Oh, love that will not let me go. That was great. Thank you. I'm going to do this all the time, people. I'm going to ask you if you can name that tune. Okay. Get you ready for potato night in October. I can't. What's going to happen? Okay. Thank you again, Gary. Okay. Next week, September the 10th, back to church. Come on, guys. We've got to get out there. This is the last weekend. They're off on holidays. So let's get those phone calls going. Let's get people reminded. Get them back here to church. Get them back into the habit of getting up on Sunday morning and coming out and worshiping with us. Okay? It's easy to get lazy on Sunday morning. Okay. September the 14th, Bible study is going to continue at my place. And Brian's going to do something different this year. He's going to do the sermon on Sunday morning. And then we're going to delve into it a little deeper on Thursday night. So pay attention to the sermon and bring all your questions to Thursday night. And we'll have a more in-depth study of it. Okay? And we have Worldwide Communion coming up on October the 1st. And the music, we'll have some special music from the choir. We're also going to have some special music from the choir on September the 17th. But October the 1st will be a very special service because it's the day of Worldwide Communion. Okay, I don't think I have anything more to add unless somebody else does. Okay, then. So Brian, we're ready to go.
Thank you. Thank you, Irene. Well, you notice we've changed the fall colors now. Even though it's still summer, we're sort of getting into the fall groove. I don't know about you, I'm not ready to let summer go yet, are you? I'd like to sort of hang on for a little bit longer. So officially we can hang on, it's the 21st of, well, Dave, of course, he's looking for winter because he wants to go skiing. Crazy man, but but you know what, that you can still do it and enjoy it, God bless you for sure. I remember the last time I went skiing was about 40 years ago. And that's why I've never gone skiing since. I won't have any details. Anyway, so good to see you here today. God bless you for being here. And for those who are watching by the internet, God bless you too. The camera is working. Everything's good. So we're ready to go. Let us begin our worship service together today by together saying, worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Give thanks to him and praise his name. Amen. Let's stand together and thank God by singing, Great is thy faithfulness.
Thank you.
God has been faithful, truly, to us. God bless you. Be seated. As we go to prayer this morning, is there anyone who has a special prayer request? You have to say it loud because you know my ears. Any have a special prayer request for this morning? None? Well, we'll just pray for all that we have been praying for all along then. Please do communicate with each other, and please communicate with me if there's anything that we need to pray about, or if there's any visits that need to be made. It's such a wonderful time of the year to travel, to enjoy what's left of the summer. We were coming to church this morning, and we had someone driving in front of us who was going real slow. And I said to Veronica, you know, it's nice to know that there are some people that still take the time to smell the roses along the way and just to enjoy life. They're not in a hurry, as the rest of us usually are. Well, let's try to do that today as we... tomorrow, of course, is Labor Day. I hate that word, labor. Ladies, any of you who've had children, you especially hate that word, labor, I'm sure. But the Lord Jesus told us that He is here to give us rest. And so let's praise God today for His promises and for His provision. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your presence with us here today. As we do take the time this morning to step aside from the duties and the cares and the pressures of the world around us, and we come to this special place together to take the time to worship you, to take the time to recall your faithfulness to us. All that you have done, all that you have faithfully brought us through. It's easy for us to forget. It's easy for us to concentrate on the past and think about all the bad things that have happened, the horrible things that we had to go through. But as we do that, Lord, as the psalmist always did, let us end our reflections with praise. God, you are with us. You do care about us. You do love us. You are our Heavenly Father. And as our Lord Jesus told his disciples long ago, he said, "You are my friends." How marvelous it is to know that you would place us in the same category as Abraham and Moses and meet with us here face to face and call us friends. Lord, help us to be faithful friends to you. Help us, Lord, to be faithful friends to each other, to our church community, to the communities in which we live, to our world in which we live. As we look around us, Lord, there is so much suffering going on, so much turmoil in various places, and yet here, safe and secure, seated squarely upon the Canadian shield, we are reminded that not only are we set upon a geological rock, but the rock of our salvation, our Lord Jesus Christ, is there, our sure, steady, dependable foundation who will never leave us, never forsake us, and will never, ever be shaken. So thank you, Lord, for the security, for the assurance we have. Father, we do pray today for our congregation, for those who are laid aside at home, unable to perhaps get out of the house. And Lord, we pray for them. Lord, we pray that your healing hand will be upon their bodies. Your healing and soothing voice will be heard, reassuring them that they are not alone and that this life is not the end. As the old song says, this world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. Well, we can say we know where they are. They're laid up in heaven, our Lord Jesus told us. So, Father, help us to regularly deposit in heaven, knowing that, Lord, we will reap joy and peace and rest for all of eternity. It's hard for us to get our minds around that. But, Lord, help us to take the time to step aside and to be quiet and to listen to you so that you can impress upon us what we need to know. Our Lord Jesus said, just look around you. Look at the birds of the air. Look at the flowers of the field. They don't have to work hard. They just have to rest and enjoy the provision of their Father. So, Father, help us not to worry about tomorrow. Help us to rejoice in today that you are here. And now, Father, as your family, together we worship you and we say the words our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we have forgiven those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Well, let's turn around, wave, say hi to everybody. So glad to have you here today. God bless you as we sing together. Teachers who are stressing out right now, maybe some of them freaking out as they anticipate going back to school and having the children return this week. So pray for the teachers, pray for the kids, pray for the mums and dads. Pray for the empty nesters. This year, for the first time, my eldest daughter and her husband, all three kids are in university now, and they're going to be totally alone. Will they be rejoicing or will they be weeping? I don't know. So pray for all the empty nesters too, the ones that are experiencing a new phase in their life. Well, we'll look forward to hear what Aunt Irene has to say for us as we welcome the children back. Right now, take a deep breath. Try it. Take a deep breath. Feels good, doesn't it? Slow the heart rate, still the mind. I'm going to sit down and together let's sing a prayer to the Lord. Breathe on me, breath of God.
Thank you.
invite Gary now to come and lead us as we share the Word of God together.
Good morning. Our responsive reading for this morning comes from Matthew, chapter 11, verses 25 to 30, which you'll find on page 1019 of your Pew Bible. Matthew 11, 25 to 30. At that time, Jesus said, "I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned, and revealed them to little children."
Yes, Father, for this was your good pleasure.
All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him.
Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest.
Take my yoke upon you, and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls.
For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light.
Our reading text for the sermon today comes from Psalm 46. You'll find this on page 595 of your Pew Bible. Psalm 46. Hear the word of the Lord. God is our refuge and strength, and ever-present help in trouble. Therefore we need not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see the works of the Lord, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spears. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Thanks be to the word of God. This ends our readings for today.
We sung this several times in the past weeks, and I want to sing it again today. Be still and know that I am God. It's taken, of course, from Psalm 46 that Gary just read for us. Let's stand together and sing to our own souls and listen to what God is saying to us. Be still and know, he says, that I am God. follow up and trust him. And just simply trust him. Well, I got a note for myself. I always forget. Zoom the camera in there so the folks at home can see a little better. There we go. Well, this is the last week. You probably noticed this morning that did you freak out a little bit when the responsive reading was not a psalm? The responsive reading was from the Gospels, from the words of Jesus. Well, this is the last week that I'll be preaching from the book of Psalms, at least for a little while. I've been preaching all through August. I hope you found the sermons to be helpful. As every day you navigate through your own life. Because when we've looked through the Psalms, I hope you've been able to see, and I think I've emphasized that written by people who are just like us, not really different, and they had some mighty tough things to go through, horrible things to go through. But the Psalms were written to let us know that, hey, they made it. They got through those hard times. So I hope that in the coming weeks you will read through the Psalms at your leisure. This month, I have a confession to make that Psalm 119 is the longest of the Psalms. I think it's 172 verses, something like that. I've preached on various, over the years, preached on various sections from Psalm 19, but these past few weeks, I actually sat down and read through the whole thing all at once, and it occurred to me that I don't remember the last time I did that. I read through the whole 119 Psalms. Some of them are really short, and that one is real long, but you know what? You need to read through them, and as you do, you find out that they're just so honest. And they help us to understand that yeah, this is the Word of God. And he's not afraid to have his people who believe in him to express their feelings, their emotions, and to ask painful questions. Like, oh God, why has this happened to me? Why do you allow such bad things to happen? And to me? And then the most poignant one of all, oh God, why don't you answer me? Now, let's face it, we all get that, don't we? We've all been there. We all know. But as you read through the Psalms, you find that in every case, almost every case, the writer ends the Psalm by saying, yes, thank you, God. You did come through for me. Or if he didn't, they know that by expressing their praise and their thanks to God for who he is, they know now, they believe in their hearts that God really will come through, and he really does love them, he really does care. So you could say that many, many of the Psalms start off with bad news, and they end with the good news. And that reminds me of a little story I saw recently. The good news and bad news stories, like the pilot comes on and he says, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know that we're having a perfect flight, perfect weather, we're making excellent time. In fact, we're ahead of schedule. The bad news is that I don't know where we're going. That could be a little disconcerting. So this is another story, sort of about a pilot. A woman was nervously waiting at the airport for her husband to return from his skydiving lesson. I actually did a couple of skydiving lessons, by the way, back when I was 36, I think it was. I went up there and actually learned how to skydive and jumped out of an airplane a couple of times. And now I look back on that and I think, what an idiot, but I did it anyway. But I enjoy having, glad I had the experience. But imagine if I were to do that now, Veronica might freak out and I wouldn't blame her. For sure. Anyway, so this lady was nervously waiting at the airport for her husband to return from his first skydiving lesson. And she's sitting there, and the pilot, of the plane approached her, and he says, I'm sorry, madam, but there's been an accident. Well, I have some bad news, and some good news, and some more bad news, and I have some more good news. And the lady is really confused by this time, what on earth is going on? So the pilot says, well, the bad news is that your husband fell out of the plane. The good news is that he has parachute on. The bad news is that he hit the ground before his chute could open. And the good news is that the plane hadn't taken off yet. Talk about an emotional roller coaster, huh? Oh, dear. As we look at Psalm 46, you can see that it is different from most of the other Psalms, because it doesn't start off with bad news. It starts off with good news. Now, the ones that start off with bad news, as I've said, they always end up by good news, by saying, yeah, God, you did come through, or I know you will. But Psalm 46 starts off with a strong statement of faith in God, and then it just builds on that good news. It never gets negative. It's positive all the way through. There's no bad news at all in Psalm 46. You probably noticed that. Right from verse 1, it says, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Isn't that great? Wow. The rest of the world will be terrified, but we will not fear, because God is our refuge and strength. He is present with us in all of our troubles. That's wonderful. Now, having been around here at Union for almost 11 years, as a matter of fact, this first Sunday in September, back in 2013, was the first Sunday when I was here, sort of, you know, quote unquote, full time. I preached here in January, March, and May of 2013. Then, starting in September of that year, I've been here ever since. And you haven't got rid of me yet, so I guess things are going okay. But so during that time, I've got to know you pretty well, and for those of you who have joined us in recent years, I've got to know you pretty well too, and I'm grateful for that. So the first step in having faith in God is just acknowledging His presence, acknowledging His reality. The writer of the letter to the Hebrews says in chapter 11, verse 6, without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him. And so I know that you put your faith and trust in God, you earnestly seek Him. Just being here on Sunday underlines your faith in God. It's great. Have you ever thought, though, what it would be like to live without faith in God? Most of the world does. In fact, most of the world, especially now, they not only don't have faith in God, they don't even believe that God exists. One of the most famous atheists of the last century was Bertrand Russell. I don't know if you remember him or not. He wrote things like, brief and powerless is man's life. On him and all his race, the slow, sure doom falls, pitiless and dark. He also said, my whole religion is this, to do every duty and expect no reward for it, either here or hereafter. Wow. And then finally he said, I believe that when I die, I shall rot, and nothing of my ego will survive. Wow. Well, thanks, Bert. Needed to hear that. I want to be just like you. Well, no. Boy, talk about an ego. Bertrand Russell died in 1970 at age 97. But you know, I wonder if Mr. Russell were alive today and seeing how belief in Jesus is, let's face it, is getting close to being eradicated in Western culture. I wonder if that man would still be so dogmatic in his beliefs. 60 years ago, the world was a brighter place. Let me show you a graph. I know you can't see the small print, but this shows a graph of attendance in the United States from 1952 to 2012. You can see around 1980-something, average attendance, it started to drop below the average. That horizontal line is the average. Where it had been for who knows how long, hundreds of years. And now, around that time, it started to drop below the average. And you can see that by the time it got to 2012, well, it's bottomed out. Now, if you were to take that same graph, I couldn't find one. Take that same graph and extend that from 2012 to 2023. And I think you would agree, the curve would be even steeper, wouldn't it? Almost off the page. So low. So that's the way it is with our friends in the excited states, or the disunited states. But you know what? Let's be serious. I think if we were to take that same graph for Canada, I couldn't find one, but if you could find a graph like that for Canada, you know what? I think it could be worse. I think it could be worse in Canada. Well, that's kind of depressing, isn't it? But in a way, it's sort of a little bit comforting too, is that, you know, we're not alone in being declining in numbers. A lot of churches I know are doing pretty well, seem to be doing pretty well, but you know, they're doing it by entertaining people. They're really that's what they're doing. They're entertaining them, they're you know, putting on big demonstrations that are supposed to make them believe, but that doesn't change a person's heart. And if the Word of God is not being declared faithfully, totally, without compromise, well, people aren't going to flock to hear that. But you know, I think it's been, in a way, it's been sort of good to see the decline in church attendance and in our culture these past few years. I think it's given everyone a clear picture of what it's like and what it's going to be like when God is gone and the church is out of the picture. I agree with this statement that I found, and maybe you do too. It's sort of like, you know, you heard of the law of gravity. You know, someone can say they don't believe in the law of gravity, but I don't see them stepping out of an airplane without a parachute either, right? There is a law of gravity. There's another law called the law of the vacuum. Ever heard of that one before? The law of the vacuum states that the universe dislikes empty space. In fact, they found in the universe now something called dark matter, right? The universe is not empty. It's full. They can't see it, but it's there. So the physicists are telling us. So I guess they know what they're talking about. I don't know. But the law of the vacuum states the universe dislikes empty space, and therefore it will fill it up with something, with good things or with bad things. And that's what's happening to our world today. A vacuum has been created in our culture, and it's not being filled up with anything good, pretty little good, but a whole lot of bad. And it's filling up our culture today. You take God and the Bible out of the picture, and what we are seeing right now is what you get. And I think anyone who thinks it's going to get better, well, in my opinion anyway, you're fooling yourself. It's not going to get better. It's going to get worse. I think I've said it before, and someone said to me back when I was just starting out preaching, sort of stood me up and said, "Brian, if tomorrow it became illegal to be a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict us?" He said us, which is very kind of him. "If it became illegal tomorrow to be a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you?" It's a sobering question. Jesus never told us to get out of the world. He told us to be in the world, but to be not isolated from the evil, but to be insulated from the evil. And to shine like a light in the midst of the darkness. That's what it was like in Jesus' time, and that's what it's like in our time. And although there came a time in our culture when people were going to church, I think, you know, after the Second World War, and things got desperate, so they started going to church. But now you see what happened. In the past 60, 70 years, good grief. Wow. It's changed. And it's changed drastically. So, I think if Bertrand Russell were allowed or alive today, we could say, well, Mr. Russell, so how do you like it now that the church is gone? Now that you got your wish, well, what do you think? You know what, friends? One day, when Jesus comes back, as we say he's going to, every time we have a communion service, we say, "This do in remembrance of me until I come," right? We believe he's going to come back. One day when Jesus comes back, the church will be gone, and it will be gone for good. I'm glad I'm not going to be around to see that, aren't you? Yeah, for sure. Well, I don't want to depress you. But, you know, the truth needs to be spoken. Well, what's that got to do with Psalm 46? Let's get back to Psalm 46. We all believe, right along with the writer, as I said at the beginning, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Amen to that, right? God is our refuge and strength. Lord, we believe you. We trust you. We know you're here. We can't see you with our eyes, but we see with the eye of faith, and we believe you, and we trust you. You're going to come through for us. But you know what? Believing that with the head is a whole lot different than believing it with the heart. Someone has said the distance between heaven and hell is 18 inches. It's about the distance between your head and your heart. You know, believing it in your head is one thing. Believing it with your heart is something else. The one is intellectual belief. The other is practical, real belief. Putting your belief to the test. That is something else altogether. So, as we look at Psalm 46, what are the two major things in the world in which we live today that can shake our faith to its very foundation? There are two. And they're stated here in Psalm 46, which makes it really current. Here's the first one. How about a natural disaster? Like an earthquake. Or like a forest fire that turns into a wildfire. What about that? Psalm 46 puts it very well, and it applies exactly today as it did thousands of years ago when it was written. "We will not fear," it says, "though the earth give way," it sounds like an earthquake to me, "though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging." So, we're safe here in southern Ontario. Although, how many of you remember 1954? I was 7 years old at the time. Some of you weren't here in 1954, but in 1954, Hurricane Hazel struck struck the greater Toronto area. And it wasn't Hazel McCallion, the former mayor of Mississauga, was called Hurricane Hazel. A real hurricane actually hit here. Good grief. We had relatives that had to, that lived right near Black Creek, not too far from where we lived, a couple of miles from where we lived. They had to escape their house by rowboat. We were higher, so we were okay. But I remember it well. Natural disasters. What about right now? For those poor people in Hawaii, in the island of Maui, who were literally burned out of their houses, burned alive in their homes. Horrific. So far, as far as I could tell, about 115 have been confirmed dead, and over 100 are still missing. It could be 1,000. They still haven't figured it out yet. It's horrible. And what about if we were living in Tornado Alley? You know that Tornado Alley? That's that trough that runs through Alabama, Georgia, Louisiana, Texas, and Mississippi. They know hurricanes come. Remember the Wizard of Oz? Remember Dorothy? That was in Kansas, wasn't it? So they hit Kansas, or whatever. When's the last time we had a tornado here? Do you know? 1988. It went through Grand Valley? Went through Barrie? Yes, that close to us. It was horrific. My son and I were driving along Highway 400 going through there just after the tornado hit, and I said to him, "Good grief, what happened?" He didn't know. It was horrible. So bad things can happen. We call them natural disasters. How about the Gulf of Florida right now, the Gulf Coast? That hurricane, Inelda is it called? I forget the name anyway. Just hit Fort Myers, and it's going through Florida right now as we speak, and it's going to exit on the Atlantic coast. They don't know how many people have been killed during that, left homeless. And how would you like to live there knowing for sure that during hurricane season, every year, one or more hurricanes is going to barrel through there? As I said in my opening prayer, we live safe and secure here, Eastern Canada. Safe on the Canadian Shield. The mountains beneath us. Rocks that will never move. This church is built on a sure foundation of giant boulders, so I understand. So Dave has told me. This church has not moved one inch, one centimeter in the 100 and whatever years since it was built in 1884. We're so safe and secure, and along with safety and security goes that word called complacency, right? We get so complacent. And we look at what's happening around the world and we say, wow. And how about war? That's the other thing that can shake us. Some of you here this morning know what it's like to live through a war in your own lifetime, back in Pakistan, right? Not conventional war, but a war of ideals, a war of ideas that can just as easily disrupt families, kill families, and drive them away from their homes. That's what war does. It can shake our faith, but will it cause us to abandon it? Psalm 46 describes it to a T. It says, "Nations are in uproar." They are in uproar. War rages. Kingdoms fall. And what is God's answer to all of this? You know, the God who we have already said that we believe is real. The God who we believe is watching over us. Our heads tell us that. We believe that. Psalm 46 goes on to say, God lifts his voice. Lifts his voice. The earth melts. He makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow, shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Now that's describing ancient weapons. But you can just as easily change those words to guns and tanks and rockets. I shudder to think the shock is going to hit this world when one day, as he said he would, God now again personally intervenes in the affairs of mankind. And when that happens, watch out, world. When that happens, if we happen to still be here, I'm not sure about that, but if we happen to still be here, how we need to stand and shine for Jesus. Would you agree? God is teaching us right now what we need to do to endure to the end, as the word of God tells us. So what are we to do right now? Yeah, I say stand and shine, but are we to spend our time changing the laws? Launching protests? Are we to make ourselves sick with worry and at the same time make the pharmaceutical companies rich? Is that what we're supposed to do as Christians? No. The great I Am, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one who with one word created light and life and countless galaxies in measureless space. That one, our Creator, is our Heavenly Father. He's our Father. He's our friend. And He's our Savior. And He says in Psalm 46, "Be still and know that I am God." We're living in a world today where people are being taught to think that they are God, or that they can become God. So many of the world's religions teach that. They really do. There is one God, and it's not me, and it is not you. Be still, He says. Be still and know that I am God. And then the psalmist adds to that, the Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Other psalms say He is our high tower, our refuge in a time of trouble. Be still and know that I am God. That is God's counsel to us for the present, for right now. And His promise for the future is given us in the end of Psalm 46. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Well, it hasn't happened yet. But as I said last week, quoting that gospel song, in God's time, it will happen. You can be absolutely sure. Long ago, Jesus said to His disciples, and He's still saying it to each one of us today. He says in Luke chapter 12, seems like He's describing Union Church right now. He says, "Do not be afraid, little flock." That's us. "Do not be afraid, little flock. Are you ready? For your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom." What? How's that for a screech? What? "Do not be afraid, little flock. For your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom." Hasn't happened yet, but wow, one day it's going to. Isaiah said, and Paul repeated, Your eyes have not seen, your ears have not heard. It's never even entered into your little puny minds. I added the little puny. It hasn't even entered into your minds, the things that God has prepared for those who love him. That's what Paul said. He misquoted Isaiah on purpose. Isaiah said, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the mind of mankind the things that God has prepared for those who wait for him. Paul deliberately misquoted it. He said, for those who love him. What does that tell us? Are you ready? To love the Lord is to wait for him. And as we wait for him, we say, God, Lord, Jesus, I love you. Wow. I want to be in that family. How about you? And you know what? We're here. God bless you. As you give to the work of the Lord, as you can. A shepherd lead us. This is our prayer to the Lord as we depart for today. God bless you as we sing together. As we leave this sacred place this morning, may we feel your presence with us through the power of the Holy Spirit, through the promise of our Lord Jesus that he will return. Lord, as we began this morning, we end now by saying, great is your faithfulness, O God, our Father. Amen.